All right, well, thank you, Stacy, for the prelude there. Welcome to Asbury, welcome to church this morning. I really believe like we're gonna have a great service this morning. I feel like God wants to do some things in our hearts and in our lives this morning. And I know yesterday we had a great ladies' retreat. And it was a fantastic time, and I know Michelle was here. She spoke. A lot of the ladies were blessed. Amanda sang. So that was a great time. And then Thursday, we had a very powerful prayer service here. We are here Thursday for prayer, which we have weekly on Thursdays at 6:30. And it was just a powerful time in the Lord. And so I want to invite you out for that. If you can make it out, you'll be blessed because the powerful church is the church that prays, amen. And so you guys come out for that. I want to mention the Royal Ball that'll be happening on February 22nd. That's on a Saturday, starting at 4:00. So a Royal Ball for ages. All right. Well, good. Heirs to the throne. Awesome. So make sure you come out for that and spread the word February 22nd. And also, we've got a big announcement to make. You know, I don't know how long it's been since we've had another service or a midweek service, but we're starting on February the 5th. We're going to have the midweek service on Wednesday nights now. You can come out to church. This is going to be just a casual setting where there's going to be prayer testimonies. We'll try to incorporate some testimonies, prayer requests, a lesson in Scripture, worship, and communion, and however else the Holy Spirit leads. So be sure to come out for that Wednesdays at 6:30 starting on February the 5th. Wednesday, 6:30, starting on February the 5th, the Refresh Service. Also, in your bulletins, you should have another insert. One insert is about the Wednesday night service. And also, I want to add this. What we're going to do each month is we're going to have the midweek service, and then the last Wednesday of each month, we're going to have a meal, a church-wide meal or community meal. And so that's the way that's going to kind of play out. So again, midweek service, Refresh Service, starting February 5th at 6:30. The last Wednesday of each month will be just a church-wide meal. Also, inside of your bulletins, there's an insert for three questions. And those three questions are, what do you wonder about? What do you worry about, and what do you wish for? And so we've done this for 2 weeks, and we have gotten some really awesome responses. And the plan is we're going to take your responses to these three questions, and I'm going to study them, and that's going to be the guidepost for the content of the sermons that are preached here for the next several months. And there's been some amazing answers. I mean, absolutely phenomenal. So I went through all the answers and started grouping them into themes. And there's some themes which are very, very popular. For example, family, about your family members being saved. That's one of the most popular here. And this allows us to understand each other better. It allows these messages to become relevant in our life, in our spiritual walk, and in our journey. And so we're going to take these themes, and I've started to group them. We're going to chart them out, make a chart and a graph, and I'm going to share these with you next week and show you what is the most popular. And man, I'm telling you, it goes from, you know, can you lose your salvation to can you smoke marijuana? Different questions. But yeah, so it's really good. So I'm going to have to preach one on marijuana, and so that'll be fun. But anyway, so I'm going to go through these and preach. So today, we're going to extend this. This has been such a popular thing that we've extended this by one more week. So if there's anything that you wonder about, worry about, or wish for, you can go ahead, and if you've done one, that's fine. You can do another. Fill these out sometime today, and then you can place them in the offering plate at the end when we collect and re-receive your tithes and offerings. So you can do that. If there's any tough Bible passages, scripture passages that you've always wondered about, you can write that down as well. And that'll be where we're preaching at for the next several months. So I want to open up service, the scripture reading from Revelation chapter 21. And I was leaning toward maybe preaching this morning since we're close to the new year, but I thought we could open up service with it. Revelation 21, verses 1 through 8 says this: "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people. And God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain any more, for the former things have passed away.' And he who was seated on the throne said, 'Behold, I'm making all things new.' Also he said, 'Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true.' And he said to me, 'It is done. I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give from the spring of water of life without payment. The one who conquers will have this heritage, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. But as for the cowardly, the faithless, the detestable, as for murderers, the sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars, their portion will be in the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death.'" We'll get to that last part in just a moment, but all things new. This is appealing to us because as humans, we're always deteriorating. We're, from the moment we're born, we begin to die, and we're losing things. And that's why the health and beauty industry is so popular. It's about applying beauty, right? Because we're, as we grow older, not to say we get uglier, but we absolutely begin to decay. We begin to go downhill. And there's this thing about making ourselves new. And this is actually an eternal truth, that Jesus Christ is going to make all things new for all of us. And this is appealing to us, right? This is appealing to us to understand that our heartaches will one day be passed away, that the tears from our eyes will be wiped away. And we see that because of sin, everything is affected, even creation. Mike around us is affected. Driving to church this morning, I seen a rabbit that had been hit by a car dead in the road. And we see deer that are constantly on the side of the road. We see volcanoes. We see like the fires in Australia. There's a sense that because of what mankind has done, because of the sin that we commit, that even creation suffers the consequences of that. It's like a watch. And if you were to take out one of the cogs, right, the whole watch would begin to fail. And that's what's going on here in the earth now. But Scripture promises us that Jesus is going to make all things new, and that He is going to give us what we desire. And there's a sense that we can experience that now, right? Maybe when we wonder why. One of the questions in those responses is, why am I sick? Why do I not receive healing when others do? Is it because of a lack of faith? Well, I want to tell you, no. But what I do want to tell you is this, that we can experience a new creation now, this morning, in terms of our thought patterns, in terms of our emotional statuses, in terms of this spiritual regeneration which occurs. It's an already in the kingdom of God, but not yet. We don't get the fullness of glorified bodies, but we can begin to experience a transformed life, transformed thinking, transformed emotions, transformed behaviors. You guys remember, in the Garden of Eden, there was a tree. What was the tree called? The tree of life. Right? And if you were to partake of that tree, the fruit of that tree, you received eternal life. Well, there's another tree that stood on a hill, Calvary. And from that tree, the cross, you could receive eternal life forevermore. Jesus with His arms extended out to you. And if you receive and approach Him in faith, you can begin to experience all things new. But what about this last part of Revelation 21? When it says that who's not going to inherit eternal life? The cowardly, the faithless, the detestable, for murderers, the sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and liars. So if they're not going to inherit eternal life, who will? Will it be the honest? Will it be the sexually pure? Will it be the moralistic? That's not what Scripture says. Scripture said, now I want to say this, all of these things are a fruit of right living, right? As you journey toward Jesus Christ in heaven, you're going to have these characteristics should mark your life. And I always teach holiness and obedience and righteousness as we will this morning. But at the core of this message, who receives eternal life? It's not the moralistic. It says right here that those who receive eternal life, to the thirsty. To the thirsty I will give from the spring of water of life without payment. Are you thirsty this morning? Are you thirsty for righteousness? Are you thirsty for peace? Are you thirsty for joy? Jesus extends His arms to you, and the invitation is before you. Come and drink from the water from which you'll never thirst no more. The water of life, Corey. The water of life that will absolutely regenerate your heart and give you life forevermore. Let's bow our heads. Father, we thank You so much for this day, Jesus. We thank You for the life that You give us. And Lord, this morning we pray that You absolutely captivate our hearts. Lord, we pray that You have Your way in this service this morning. Have Your way in our lives, Lord. And a lot of us may come here this morning and we're thirsty. We're thirsty for resolution. We're thirsty for righteousness. We're thirsty for greater trust and faith. And so, Father, You say that You'll in likewise turn nobody away that seeks You. And so, Lord, we pray, fill us this morning with Your life. Fill us with what we need this morning, Lord, as we turn our hearts and our focus and our attention unto You. For from You spring forth waters of eternal life. Have Your way in our hearts. Have Your way in this service this morning. In Your name, Jesus. Amen.
Good morning. If you can stand with us and worship this morning. We're going to start with the old rugged cross, and you guys help us out. Everybody knows it, and let's just worship the King of Kings this morning.
For a world of lost sinners, one the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. And so I'll cherish the old rugged cross until my trophies at last I lay down, and I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a old rugged cross, stained with blood so divine, a wondrous beauty I see. For the dear Lamb of God, he left his glory above to pardon and sanctify me. And so I'll cherish the old rugged cross until my trophies at last I lay down, and I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. And to the old rugged cross I will ever be true. Its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory for heaven I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down, and I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a earthquake before, moved by the sound of his voice. Seas that are shaken and stirred will be calmed and broken for my regard. And through it all, my eyes are through it all, it is well. Oh, it is well. Through it all, my eyes are on you, and it is well with me. be it for me to not believe. Even when my eyes can't see, and this mountain that's in front of me will be thrown into the midst of the sea. And through it all, my eyes are on you, Lord. And through it all, it is well, it is well. Through it all, my eyes are on you, and it is well, it is well. Atmosphere's changing now, for the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around, yes it is, that the Spirit of the Lord is here. You see, the atmosphere is changing now, for the Spirit of the Lord is here. He's all around. The evidence is all around. Yes, it is, that the Spirit of the Lord is here. Overflow in this place, fill our hearts with your love surrounds us. You're the reason we came to encounter your love surrounds us. Overflow. Overflow in this place and fill our hearts with your love surrounds us, yes it does. See, you're the reason we came to encounter your love. Your love surrounds us. Spirit of God, for fresh on us, we need your presence. Yes, we do. Your kingdom come, let your will be done here as in heaven. A miracle can happen now, for the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around, yes it is, that the Spirit of the Lord is here. So overflow in this place, God, fill our hearts with your love surrounds us, you're the reason. You're the reason we came to encounter your love surrounds us. So Spirit of God, fall fresh on us, we need your presence. Your kingdom come, and your will be done here as in heaven. A miracle can happen now, for the Spirit of the Lord is here. Yes, he is. Oh, I see the evidence, it's all around, that the Spirit of the Lord is here.
So, Father, we thank you so much, Lord, for your presence that's here. We thank you, Father, that you bestow upon us your love and your grace and your mercy. And Lord Jesus, we thank you that your name is holy in this place. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for the gift of life and of peace. And we thank you for your Holy Spirit, which is here this morning. We thank you, Lord, that we can experience and encounter your truth and your wisdom and your love and your Holy Spirit in our lives this morning. And so, Lord, I pray that you help me to preach. Lord, remove me. Holy Spirit, be here in this pulpit to speak to your people this morning. Lord, encourage us by your word. Holy Spirit, work with the hearing of your word, Father, so that we are changed to reflect your glory here on this earth. Thank you for your truth, for your wisdom, for your spirit, and your light which shines through us. In your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. If you have your Bibles, you can turn to Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3, and the title of this morning's message is In Christ. But as I was thinking, looking through those cards, a lot of questions that people had seemed to center around, what does it mean to be in Christ? And what does it look like to say that you're in Christ? And what is it all about to say, actually, what does it mean that you are in Christ? And I believe this kind of shows us the pathway to what that means. Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. If then you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with Him in glory. There's a lot here, and it may take a couple weeks to unpack this, but I want to start by saying this, that there are two engines or driving forces within the life of a Christian. And those two things are repentance and faith. Repentance and faith. And a good definition for repentance, we know that it's turning from ourselves and turning to God. Or you could also say this, that repentance is identifying and removing those idols that are in our lives. Identifying and removing idols. That's repentance. And faith, you could say that faith is finding who you are in Jesus Christ and finding your identity not so much in you, right, and not so much in the good things that you do, the good church member that you are, the good Christian you are, but rather faith is finding your identity in the person and work of Jesus Christ. The Christian life, two facets, repentance, faith. Remove idols, trust in Jesus, right? Are you with me? So that's where we're starting at here. And so first, to understand this, we have got to understand about this word righteousness. It's a very Christianese word, and we hear it a lot, but in order for us to understand the gospel, we've got to understand what does this word righteousness mean. We hear it a lot, and a lot of times it's one of those words that when we hear it, I think of just a stuffy shirt, that's just a boxed-in shirt, right? A formal, tied down, tight, restricted. This is just me, guys. Maybe it's just me. But I think a stuffy, somebody that's stuffy, right? Righteous. That's not it at all. It's completely different. Righteousness. Romans 10, verses 1 through 4. Right? A little precept. We are building the foundation to understand what righteousness means. Romans 10, 1 through 4. Brothers, my heart's desire and prayer to God for them is that they may be saved, for I bear them witness that they have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. For being ignorant of the righteousness of God and seeking to establish their own, they did not submit to God's righteousness. I'm going to read verse 3 again. For being ignorant, that's not knowing of the righteousness of God, and seeking to establish their own, they did not submit to God's righteousness. For Christ is what? The end of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes. They, Paul's talking about, tried to make a righteousness of their own. Philippians 3, verses 7 through 10. But whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For His sake I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in Him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ. The righteousness from God that depends on faith. So, what is righteousness? In the Bible, righteousness is a relational word. It's a relational word, and it means to be right with somebody. It means to be right with somebody. And the opposite of righteousness is not immorality. I'll say that again. The opposite of righteousness is not immorality. The opposite of righteousness is rejection. The opposite of righteousness is rejection. To be righteous is to be accepted. To be righteous is to be in right standing with someone. Here's an example. Have you ever felt underdressed for anything? For an event? Have you ever went somewhere and you're wondering about what should I wear? And you try your best to find out what you should wear, and all indicators told you that this was just going to be a casual event. You're going boot scooting boogie on a Friday night, and they tell you, right, hopefully you're not. I just use that as an example, right? But you go to this thing, you think it's going to be a hoedown, I should say. You think it's going to be your cowboy hat, jeans, and boots. And you go there, and it's a black tie event. You're not accepted. Or let's put it a better way. Let's say you go for a job interview, and you go to the job interview, and you think that you're going to be well, and you're worried about what you look like, how you're going to present yourself, and you go to the job interview, and you've got three people interviewing you. They're all in suits and ties, and for whatever reason, maybe it's the best thing you can afford, and you've just got maybe holes in your slacks, holes in your shoes, and you're sitting there, and you feel unaccepted, right? You feel rejected, and you're nervous because of the verdict that's going to come through to you, right? You are unaccepted. Or other words, you are not righteous. You're not in right standing with the person who's interviewing you. And you wonder if the person who's interviewing you sees your flaws. You wonder if the person that's interviewing you can see through or underneath your shoes and perceive that there's a hole there. And you're nervous. You're filled with anxiety. But if you do get the job, right, let's say you do get the job. You're elated. You're excited because they found you worthy and they accepted you. That's righteousness. That's what it means to be in right standing with somebody. Another example. Let's say you're proposing for marriage. And you put your best efforts forward, right? You put your best efforts forward. You act your best, you dress your best, you put everything on Front Street, right? And you it's leading up to the big day. I remember when I was dating Amanda, the first date we went on, and I may have told you guys this, but I don't know how she ever went on a second date with me. I had camouflage shorts on, a striped t-shirt, a ghost white legs, right, and peach shoes. It was awful. It was awful, but for whatever reason, she decided to go on that second date with me. Talking about righteousness. So let's just say in this case of your proposing, and you said it all before them, and you asked for their hand in marriage, and you get to that point, and they say no. What if they say no? You're rejected. You're crushed. And do you get the idea? That's what righteousness is about. Righteousness is about finding favor in somebody's eyes. In the job interview, when you find favor, that's righteousness. When you're proposing to somebody and you find favor, that's righteousness. And when you go to an event, you fit in. You're dressed well. You are accepted. That's righteousness, right? Are you with me? All right. Everybody tries to make a righteousness of their own. Everybody tries to make a righteousness of your own, right? And our whole lives, we live these lives, Jason, where we come out of the womb and we're trying to be accepted. We're trying to gain approval, and we go through life and people are constantly passing verdicts on us. We go to kindergarten, we get a U, unsatisfactory. You failed nap class or something. You go on through school and you're set outside and you receive bad grades. You get reprimanded. You try out for the football team, you get cut from the football team. It's these verdicts that keep piling up and piling up and piling up. You're born into a family, and maybe you have 7, 8 siblings, or maybe you're an only child. It doesn't matter, but you're trying to gain acceptance in the eyes of your parents, and you hear through verbal or nonverbal cues that you don't measure up. It builds and builds and builds, and so you try to create a righteousness of your own. Right, you try to achieve certain things. You try to get all of these trophies and these scores. You try to look good. You try to do these major accomplishments. Why? So that you'll gain acceptance. We build these things. We build these things. We build these things. And over time, they accumulate. And you set standards for what you think will make you acceptable. And what your parents said, what your friends said. And over time, guys, it weighs you down. And it's crushing. It's crushing. It's crushing you. And you try to set up your own standard of righteousness. And that is the definition of sin. Setting up a righteousness of your own is the definition of sin. It's what Scripture tells us. What's the result of all this, right? We do, and it can be, even be those great things, which we'll get to in just a moment. I know there was a time in my life when I had ripped and run, and I thought the right thing to do was to just get in church and to do this and to date that one. And I did it, right? My heart was never right. I never gave my life over to Jesus, but I did all of the externals. I was setting up my own righteousness, and it was sinful. Pay attention here. This is about doing those things which you set forth to gain approval. And what's the result of all this? Two things. It's going to leave you with guilt or anxiety. Guilt or anxiety. Guilt that you're going to miss those own standards for yourself that you've set up. And so you didn't get that promotion. You're filled with guilt. And you failed at doing good again, right? You try to do good. You're all about behaviors. You're all about externals with no inner life change, with no inner increase in faith. And so you go about trying to do certain things. And when you fail, you're full of guilt. Setting up a standard for your own righteousness. When you don't achieve it, you're filled with guilt. Or maybe you do achieve it. Maybe you do hit those benchmarks. Maybe you do got a good streak of good luck. But as you're doing those things, there's something in the back of your mind that's saying, man, your luck's going to run out. This is all going to come to an end at some point. How long can you keep this up? And you're filled with anxiety because you're thinking at any moment, I can lose it. And a lot of times in midlife crises, you see that opportunity is passing you by. You thought you were going to do this thing to gain acceptance. You thought that by accomplishing this, you would gain notoriety. You would put your mark on the world. And you quickly realize that time is passing by. And you're anxious. You're nervous. You're a train wreck. What's the answer? The answer is the gospel. There is a righteousness which comes from God, and you have to count your own righteousness as absolute rubbish and trash. And Scripture says that our righteousness, right, is as filthy rags. And the Hebrew word there is something a lot more than filthy rags. Look it up, bedad. Bedad is something that's absolutely treacherous. It's absolutely repulsive. And Scripture says that our righteousness is repulsive as filthy rags. Gospel says, stop trying to steal acceptance from this world and acceptance from other people and from other things, and warm your heart at the fire of Jesus Christ. Or another way, the only verdict that matters is the one you receive from Jesus Christ. God accepts me. That's the only verdict that matters. That's the one that transforms our hearts. And the gospel says, swallow your pride. Admit that you are unacceptable in your own terms, in your own methods, in your own ideas. Swallow your pride. Admit that you're unaccepted and receive the righteousness from God. I heard a quote that said, I forget who said it, but a preacher was talking to somebody along these lines and said, look, maybe the reason you have low self-esteem is because you have an accurate representation of yourself. We need to realize, right, I'm not advocating low, I'm all about confidence in Christ. But what this is saying is that we need to realize that we cannot do it, guys. It don't matter how much money you give. It don't matter how many consistent Sundays you go to church. Your righteousness, my righteousness, is wrecked and wretched as any filthy rag you can imagine. Our only chance, our only hope is the righteousness from God. That we turn from ourselves and turn to God. And we've got to remind ourselves of this every day. And this is the message that converts people. I've got one point this morning in the sermon. One point. And it's this. What Jesus did for us. What Jesus did for us. And He did two things. And He did obedience in two forms and fashions. First, there was passive obedience. Second, there's active obedience. First, passive obedience. We know that Jesus came and obeyed God for dying for our sins, that He paid our debt. And that means, like, if you're about to get evicted from your home and somebody shows up and says, no, here, I've got your mortgage payment. You don't owe anything. I'm going to pay it off. Pay off all of your home loan. That's like receiving what Christ has done, right? He paid our debt. And if you're homeless, right, it's not only having your debt paid. There's a sense of rejection there, of unacceptability, right? I remember during a period in my life when I was in a homeless shelter, it's like everywhere that you go, you feel unworthy, right? Walking the streets, you feel dirty, right? You go into a store, right? You feel unworthy. You can't look people in the eyes, right? Because you're unworthy. You're rejected by society. And this part of the gospel message comes and Jesus shows up and says, look, your debt is paid. But it doesn't stop there. The second thing is this active obedience that Christ has done for us. Not only did He obey God and came to die for our sins, but He did so much more, right? He fulfilled all righteousness. Do you guys remember when in Scripture, when John is there and he's baptizing people and he sees Jesus and Jesus asks him to baptize him. And John says, I'm not worthy. You should be the one baptizing me. What does Jesus say? Matthew 3:15. Jesus answered him, let it be so now, for thus it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness. Jesus was the perfect man, and He did everything that God had required. He did everything that was expected and commanded of Him. He was obedient to the letter of the law. He did everything. And when you turn to Him, you receive His righteousness. You get treated for everything that He has done. You receive His righteousness. So not only do you get your debts and your sins removed, you get a parade thrown in your honor. You get a trophy. You get a day to celebrate you because of what Jesus has done. It's like you get not only your debts are forgiven, you get unlimited gift certificates to Walmart or to Amazon, right? You get above and beyond. You're not just starting at ground zero. You get credited with the absolute beauty and behavior and obedience of Jesus Christ. Wanda, that's accredited to your account. It's not like you're just barely scraping by. Your claim is on the blood of Jesus Christ. Your identity is on the authority and obedience of Jesus Christ. Righteousness from God. Why would Jesus listen to your prayers last week when you had such a horrible week? Listen to me. Why would God listen to your prayers when He's seen you get angry in traffic? Why would God listen to your prayers when He heard you cuss? And by the way, don't blame that on your pastor about cussing. I won't get into that now. But anyway, why in the world would God listen to my prayers when I've not been as obedient as I could have been? Why? Because your prayers getting through is not based on your righteousness, but it's based on Jesus Christ. Hebrews says that He is our high priest, right? He is the one that we appeal to, right? He is our advocate. He is the intermediary that wipes out all other intermediaries. He is our priest. And when we pray, when we are in Him, we are what? Scripture says we are hidden in Christ. We are what? Hidden in Christ. Not based on us, based on Him. Another illustration. Anyway, back to those gift certificates. Those gift certificates, those gift certificates, that's your prayer life. You can pray. You have the luxury of pleading with God. Sue, you have a luxury of pleading with God at any time. It's the benefits of being in Christ. Not only are your sins wiped away, you can approach the throne of grace at any time. It's that luxury that you have that you can plead. Or better yet, an illustration in a courtroom. How many know that when you go to court, maybe some of you don't, or maybe some of you have been there 18 times like I have, but you go to court and however your lawyer behaves, you get accredited with that. If your lawyer's a jerk, the judge looks on you like you're a jerk. If your lawyer is eloquent, you are perceived as being eloquent. If your lawyer is effective and judicious and gracious, then that is applied to you. The behavior of your lawyer is imputed to you. If your lawyer can defend you, you go home scot-free, right? If your lawyer is terrible, you're going to go behind the bars, right? And so the courtroom, in the courtroom of heaven, Jesus is our attorney. Now listen. I used to think that it worked out like this. So you've got a big courtroom. You've got God as the judge. You've got Jesus as your advocate. And here He's representing Jason Roop. And Jason Roop messes up, right? And Jesus goes to God and says, "Father, have mercy on him. He's messed up again," right? And then so God grants mercy. And then I mess up again. And then Jesus comes back and says, "Lord, show him mercy," right? He's really messed up, but he's got good intentions. And so God, okay, we'll wipe it clean. And then Jason's good to go for another 2, 4, 6, 8 hours, right? And then I mess up. So it's this continual pleading where Jesus is the cool guy saying, "Look, wipe him clean, right? Show mercy. But it's not like that at all. According to Scripture, it's not like that at all. Jesus doesn't ask for mercy. He asks for justice. He asks for justice because He goes to the Father and says, "Lord, You are absolutely just in Your condemnation of all sin. Lord, You're absolutely just in that sin deserves to be punished with death and for all eternity. But Father, I paid the price. And Father, look at me, Your righteous, obedient one. And so therefore, everything that I have done, You give to this one that I'm defending." And so justice requires a full acquittal in the name of Jesus. Wow. A full acquittal. And so guys, we have to stop trying to make ourselves acceptable. And it's only because of what Jesus has done that we are acceptable. And even trying to do all of the religious things in an effort to gain acceptance will not save you. We do these things. We come to church. We pray. We partake in communion. We are obedient to the teachings of Christ because we've been saved. Remember that we don't do those things to gain salvation. It's a result of it. And God gives us His righteousness through faith. There's several accounts throughout history of, of great men of God that when they've grasped this is their biography or autobiographies that they've written down, when they've understood the gospel message, that it's a righteousness of Christ that they have, that it's not dependent upon their merits, but upon the goodness, grace, and obedience of Jesus Christ. And it's like when we realize that the earth is shattered, the foundations of our lives are shattered, and the grace and Holy Spirit come into our lives and transform us. Nathan Cole, 1740, said this, "My hearing him," talking about a gospel preacher, "gave me a heart wound. And by God's blessing, my whole foundation was broken up, and I saw that my own righteousness could not save me." Charles Wesley, after reading a commentary by Martin Luther, I believe it was on the book of Galatians, says this, "Then there came such a power over me that I could not describe, that my great burdens came off in an instant. My heart was so filled with peace and love that I burst into tears." Have you ever felt like this? As Amanda comes up to the piano, have you ever felt like bursting into tears at what Christ has done? And salvation is that radical. And salvation is so, it seems like scandalous, that it should lead us, like those in Scripture that should say, well, what? Should we sin? Keep on sinning again? And Paul says, God forbid, no. But righteousness and salvation is that miraculous. It is that great. And no, we should not keep sinning, right? But the motivation, listen to me, the motivation of righteousness is not fear. It is love. We don't obey because we're afraid of hell. We obey because we've been captivated by the love of Christ. Our lives have been transformed, right? Our whole worlds have been turned upside down because of what God has done for us. And finally, we should realize that through the gospel that we have unlimited access and potential. We can go boldly before the throne of God, and we can pray to God as a loving Father. And we stand right now in a glorious place of full acceptance, right? Realize that, understand that God looks upon you and He's not like, oh, you again. Nope. Scripture says He looks at you and says, my beloved. When I'm for you, who can be against you? I've got your name written on the palm of my hand. We realize that we can go before God, the Creator of the universe, and we can plead with Him like children to a father. And think about it. It's not based upon you and how good you are and about how legalistic you think you've been. It's not about all of these things at all. But it's based upon everything that Jesus Christ has done. And the question becomes, do you really believe that? Or do you think it's too good to be true? I want to tell you that it is too good, but it is also true. That Jesus Christ has lived His life and accredited unto you by faith His righteousness. 1 John 3:3 says this, "And everyone who thus hopes in Him purifies himself as He is pure." Who's pure? Those who what? Hope in Him. If we behold His glory, we're transformed into it. So this morning, set your mind on things above and transfer your trust to Him. And this morning you have the opportunity to turn to Him and to turn all of your trust over to Him. And we're going to come to the table this morning in just a moment, an opportunity to take communion. But this is what it's about. This is coming. When we come to the table, we realize that our righteousness is as filthy rags. And we come, and this is the great exchange that happens. Even our best efforts could not earn salvation, but Christ Jesus has given it unto us. Why? Because He loves us and He's called us. I'd like to ask my father-in-law, Roger, if he'll come up to the front here to help me serve communion. I'd like for all of us, right? So now we've seen that the righteousness of God is righteousness from Christ Jesus, not a righteousness based on our own. And when we come to the table, Scripture invites us into a place of asking for forgiveness. We are told to search ourselves. And this is an opportunity to allow the Holy Spirit to search us and to ask for forgiveness. So I'd like to ask you, if you would please bow your head. And over the next few moments, 30 seconds or so, to confess your sins to the Father. Lord Jesus, we thank you for Calvary. We thank you for your blood which washes us and cleanses us. Lord, we thank you that you give us your righteousness, Jesus. That you clothe us in a robe of righteousness which is unparalleled. And that now that when we turn to you, we've been fully forgiven of all of our sins. The slate has been wiped clean. So thank you for the atonement. Thank you for cleansing us. And Lord, we partake of communion, Lord, to remember what you've done and also to look for your return, Lord Jesus. And so, Lord, I pray that you make this bread and this juice your body and your blood for us so that we can be your body in this world, Lord Jesus. Now, as they're eating, Jesus took the bread, and after blessing it, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body." He took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he said, "Take, drink, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." The invitation is open to you. This is your chance to exercise that repentance and faith, to repent from your sins, to come in faith to receive of the righteousness of Jesus Christ. If you can, come maybe down this way and pass through. The altars are open, but now the time is before you. The invitation is open. Come and receive.
Old things have passed away. Your love has stayed, oh, just the same, and your constant grace remains our cornerstone. Oh, and things that we thought were dead, oh, breathing in life again, and you cause your sun to shine on darkest nights. Oh, for all that you've done, we will pour out our love. This will be our anthem song. Jesus, we love you. Oh, how we love you. You are the one our hearts adore. Jesus, how we love. Oh, Jesus, we love you. And we're so thankful. Oh, how we love you. Oh, you've been faithful, God. You are the one that our hearts adore. The hopeless have found their hope. The orphans now have a home, and all that was lost has found its place in you. And you lift our weary head, You make us strong. Instead, Lord, you took these rags and you made us beautiful. For all that you've done, we will pour out our love. This will be our anthem song. Oh, Jesus, we love you. Oh, how we love you. You are the one our hearts adore. Oh, Jesus, how we love. Oh, Jesus, we love you because we're so thankful. Oh, how we love you. You are the one our hearts adore.
Body of Jesus Christ broken for you. Father, I pray that you just pour out your spirit of love and compassion upon Lane in the name of Jesus, Father.
And our affection, our devotion, we pour out on the feet of Jesus. Our affection, our devotion, we pour out on the feet of Jesus. Our affection, our devotion, we pour out on the feet of Jesus. Our affection, our devotion, we pour it out on the feet. Oh, Jesus, we love you. Yes, we do. Oh, how we love you. You are the one our hearts adore. Jesus, how we love. Oh, Jesus, we love you and we're so thankful. Oh, how we love you. You've been faithful, God. You are the one our hearts adore. Our hearts adore.
But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this message that we've just heard. Please help us to repent. Please let us be joyful in the faith and follow you. Follow you and stand with you as we shall righteously. Let us learn and adapt the things that we've heard as we receive these tithes and offerings for your house. Lord, these are for you to share with us what we need to do in your house. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Next week, we're going to start our series through exploring the answers to these questions. I want to remind you again, if you've got any questions, you can write them down, put them in the offering plate. Also, I want to announce that we've got a TV in the nursery now that live streams the service from in here. So we're actively looking for nursery workers. So if you do feel led of the Lord to volunteer and serve in the nursery, that is one of the benefits that you'll be able to see and hear me in the nursery. At least participate in the service. So anyway. All right, if we could please stand, and I'll dismiss in prayer. So Father, thank you so much for this day. We thank you for your righteousness that you've bestowed upon us. Father, I pray that you go with us to lead us and to guide us. Lord, be our strength and our shield and make your face shine upon us. Make your countenance shine upon us and give us your peace. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen and amen. You are dismissed.